Morning, everybody. Can I give a very warm welcome to you and also to those that are joining by watching us on YouTube as well. It was lovely to walk into a nice warm church this morning after the cold, wasn't it? It's nice to be in a warm church. Now, for those who don't know me, my name is Maurice Rodham. I'm the former recently retired vicar at Patterdale, and I'm now living in Penrith, and I help out occasionally in services here when David's not around. So it's good to be back. I've been here a few times now. Lovely to see you all. The service is morning worship, and it is on the service sheet. All the notices that are required are on the other sheet as well, and I have some banns of marriage to read this week as well. So I publish the banns of marriage between Nathan Christopher Bailiff of this parish and Naomi Claire Weaver, also of this parish. This is for the third time of asking. And James Edward Newman of St. John's Hackney and Charlotte Claire Bernard of St. James the Less, Bethnal Green, also for the third time of asking. If anybody knows any reason in law why they may not marry, you must declare it. As we begin our service, let's pray for ourselves and also for these couples. Lord, the source of all true love, we pray for these couples. Grant to them joy of heart, seriousness of mind, and reverence of spirit, that as they enter into the oneness of marriage, they may be strengthened and guided by you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us stand. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Let your ways be known upon earth, your saving power among the nations. And we sing our first hymn, number 9, When Morning Gilds the Skies. Number 9.
Thank you.
We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we may give ourselves to the service of God. We sit or kneel to pray. Jesus says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins through the death of his Son. And in the power of the Holy Spirit, restore you in his image to the praise and glory of his name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. We are reconciled to God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And in our song will we praise our God. And we do that by standing to sing a version of the Gloria, number 416, 416. Night has passed, the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. And as we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
The Old Testament reading is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 25, beginning to read at the first verse. O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you, and I will praise your name. For you have done wonderful things, plans formed of old, faithful and sure. For you have made the city a heap, the fortified city a ruin. The palace of aliens is a city no more. It will never be rebuilt. Therefore, strong peoples will glorify you. Cities of ruthless nations will fear you. For you have been a refuge to the poor, a refuge to the needy in their distress, a shelter from the rainstorm and a shade from the heat. When the blast of the ruthless was like a winter rainstorm, the noise of aliens like heat in a dry place, you subdued the heat with the shade of the clouds. The song of the ruthless was stilled. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-matured wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-matured wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. This is the word of the Lord.
The New Testament reading is from Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 4. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge you, Euodia, and I urge Syntyche, to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yea, and I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing these things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. So we stand to sing our next hymn, number 800, The Lord is My Shepherd, 800.
Thank you. sit for the gospel reading. Once more, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who've been invited, look, I've prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, maltreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burnt their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' The slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who wasn't wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.'" This is the word of the Lord. May the Spirit of God guide me in my speaking and all of us in our hearing. Amen. I know, it really wasn't fair. There you were, wandering round Penrith, minding your own business, when this man comes up to you to tell you to go at once to a wedding reception. And you'd hardly got inside, you'd hardly sat down, when the host comes to you and throws you out just because you weren't wearing the right suit. It's not fair at all. So why did Jesus tell us this parable? What was his message? Wedding customs do change down the years. Last month we went down to the southwest to my brother and sister-in-law's diamond wedding anniversary. And as part of the festivities, their grandchildren had prepared a list of questions designed to test them on how much they could remember, and particularly how much they'd forgotten of that far-off day. And one of the questions was, what was the first dance at the reception? And the young were amazed to hear that there was no such thing as a dance. It was simply a service in the priory, followed by a buffet meal at the village hall, two or three speeches, and then away, finished. Customs change. But what about this wedding which Jesus describes in his parable? Multiple rejections of invitations, repeatedly, and then all and sundry called in, even if they, in spite of the fact that they had no connection with bride or groom. Those who heard Jesus long ago would know exactly what he was saying. And it was that Israel's leaders and those who followed them were like guests invited to a wedding, God's wedding party, the party he was throwing for his son. And they refused to go. The Messiah, for whom they'd waited for so long, was here. And they just didn't want to know. they had abused and killed the prophets who tried to warn them. And it wouldn't be all that long before their city was totally destroyed. But now for the good news in his parable, even if not for the leaders of Israel. God was sending out new messengers, and they were to go to all the wrong parts of town to invite anyone and everyone to come, among them the tax collectors, the prostitutes, the blind, the lame, the nobodies, all who thought they'd been forgotten, all the riffraff, as it were. And so we come this morning to one of the great words of Christianity today, inclusivity, that God's love is for all, that there are no barriers, no dividing walls, no place where that love cannot reach. Just as the table at Holy Communion is certainly here for all who wish to receive. Not so long ago that it was restricted, in the Church of England certainly, to those who had been confirmed, or as the rubric puts it, those who were ready and desirous of being confirmed. But not now. Like God's love, it's open for all. So, if God's love includes everyone, whoever they be, as we heard in the parable, good or bad, why was the man thrown out for being improperly dressed? It offends against all our instincts. Surely he too should have been welcomed. We'll come back to that. Because another of the changes in wedding customs has been what people wear. Time was, not so long ago, when one of the shops in this town did great business in hiring out morning suits and top hats to men for weddings, and after weddings sending someone round to the church to collect all the forgotten toppers. And on one occasion, one of my legal partners and I agreed that we wouldn't go to the trouble of wearing morning suits to a certain wedding. Surely it wouldn't be expected anyway. But I'm still sometimes reminded of the mortification of being married to one of the only two men there who was not properly dressed. But at least we weren't expelled, as in the parable. So, God's love is for all, yes, but the fact that God loves us does not mean that he wishes us to remain the same. He doesn't wish us to stay just as we are. God loves men who molest children. He loves murderers. He loves those who sell their bodies. He loves the nurse Lucy Letby. But of course, he wants them to change. All humans are sinners, so this applies to everyone. It includes you and me. It is not the case that I can say, God loves me, so that means that he must love me just as I am, and I needn't change at all. Because ultimately, if God is a good God, as of course he is, he cannot allow sin. It is his love that wants the best for everybody, not just as we are, which we know is so often far from the best. And that is what was wrong with the man who was thrown out. Not his failure to change what he was wearing, but his failure to change his manner of life. Jesus' parables are not always to be taken literally in their details. It would be foolish to ask, for instance, how the other last-minute guests manage to be properly dressed. But there is always in the parables a vital underlying truth. And here it is simply this: because of the love of God, we must change in response to that eternal love. At the very start of the gospel reading, Jesus said that the kingdom of heaven is like this. And this is one of a series of similar sayings. Last Sunday, you may remember, David talked about how Jesus compared the kingdom of heaven to a mustard seed, which, if you remember again, had nothing to do with mustard. And I remember, too, a memorial plaque in a church, which contained line after line of over-the-top eulogy, and then finished triumphantly: "She was bland, passionate, and religious. She painted in watercolors and was first cousin to Lady Jones. Of such is the kingdom of heaven." So this week, the comparison then is to a marriage feast. A marriage feast for which we must all put on new garments. Garments of holiness, love, mercy, joy, peace, justice, truth. Because it is these and similar characteristics that reign unchecked in the kingdom of heaven, unlike, alas, the kingdoms of earth. It's as simple and as hard as that. And so may God's kingdom come on earth as in heaven, that kingdom where peace will reign, even between Jew and Arab, perhaps especially between Jew and Arab, between Russian and Ukrainian, that kingdom where justice will thrive, justice for all, that kingdom where all will together take steps to ensure the survival of this world. That kingdom which we know that God will create because it is his will. Amen.
Thank you, Hugh. So we stand to sing our next hymn. Remembering what Hugh said about being loved by God, this hymn picks that up with that first verse. "I come with joy, a child of God, forgiven, loved, and free." We stand to sing.
I come with joy, a child of God, forgiven, loved, and free.
believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We sit or kneel to pray.
Let us pray for the church and for the world, and let us thank God for his goodness. Lord, direct our thoughts, and let us pray. Lift up our hearts to worship you, in spirit and in truth. Lord God, we thank you for the beauty and the colours of autumn which surround us. We give thanks for members of our church throughout the world, working as instruments of peace and reconciliation between people and nations at this troubled time. We ask your blessing on all who share the life in this church, for our clergy team and ministry, as we challenge ourselves to find new ways to witness God's saving love for us all. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. We pray for Isaac, who is being baptized today, and for his parents. We ask your blessing on Naomi and Nathan, James and Charlie, as they prepare for their marriage. May they all be enriched by God's presence in their lives. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. God of peace, help us as we struggle with the news of the terrible brutality and loss of life in the war between Israel and Gaza. Give courage and strength to all involved in trying to bring an end to the fighting and to bring relief for all who are caught up with injuries, loss of homes, and loved ones. We continue in our prayers for those working to find ways to relieve the consequences of war worldwide. Remember our continuing prayers for the war in Ukraine. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Lord, we pray for our community, our neighbours, family and friends. Bless all who work with children in schools, nurseries, and youth clubs. We give thanks for local charities who continue to support families with low income through food banks and the offers of financial help. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Climate changes have brought about fires and floods and earthquakes in many parts of Europe and Asia, which bring home to us all the dramatic changes to so many people's lives. May the power of the Holy Spirit inspire us to find new ways of responding to our mission to relieve suffering in faith and love. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. As autumn comes, as we are made aware of the growing pressures on our social and health services and hospital care. We ask your blessing on all who care for those who suffer in body, mind, and spirit. Remembering especially those who care for family members who are ill at home. We remember by name Roger Morton, Susie Atherton, Nick, Jean Cresswell, and Stan Blacklock. May all who care feel your presence as they support their patients and do the work of healing. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Lord, in your love, you have given us eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. We give you thanks for this great gift. We pray for those departed from us who now rest in your care. According to your promises, grant us with them a share in your eternal kingdom. I ask you to remember those who we know who have recently been bereaved. May those who have been bereaved rejoice in the richness of your love and presence in your kingdom. We give thanks for their lives and pray for the families and friends who mourn as they cope with the emotional and practical pressures of bereavement. Be with them in the time ahead. Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. We lift up our hearts and minds to you, O God. We seek your blessing on all for whom we pray and for ourselves, this day and forevermore. Amen.
Pray the collect for today. O God, for as much as without you we are not able to please you, mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. As our Savior taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. So we stand to sing our final hymn, number 650, Great is Your Faithfulness, 650.
Thank you.
Can I remind people, just before we have the grace, that if you would like some prayer for yourself or for others, so something's on your mind today, then do please make use of the prayer team who will be able to pray with you in the side chapel after the service. And also refreshments are served at the back, so do please stay for some of that. It would be good to get to know you. So we say together, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.